All right, hey, morning, everybody. Couple quick announcements. There's a homework up front that you can pick up on your way out. That's going to be due on Monday. Tuesday is the exam. The homework is on the stuff that I'm going to be talking about today, so it is not going to be material that you need to know for the exam. And so you should be doing the homework, studying for the exam. 3 o'clock tomorrow in the afternoon, Megan and Amanda will be here for a review session. They'll have a few things prepared and then also plenty of time to answer questions. And also, you should begin working on outlines for your reports. There's going to be a few more homework assignments in this unit than there was in the last one, and so you should definitely get ready for those. And then their practice exams and all of that up on Blackboard to get you ready for the test that's coming up on Tuesday. One other note, and I'll send out an email about this also. The final exam is going to have two parts to it. The final exam is going to have two parts. One part that's going to be here for an hour and a half at normal time, and then another part where you're going to have 2 hours for a take-home portion. And both parts of the exam are open book, open notes, open computer, no internet, no texting or communication or Bluetooth. You have to be like you and whatever you can carry with you, but no access to anything outside of what's like on your person for that. So you can have all of your notes and everything else for the exam for both parts of it. And I'll announce that up on Blackboard and everything. And so there's going to be some types of questions that you won't see on the exam. There's not going to be any like recall questions on the exam because those would be pretty trivial to do if you have all your notes in front of you. And so it's going to be more applications-based stuff. Any questions about that? So for example, one thing that you will see, the take-home portion of the exam, for that I'm going to give you printouts of a new scientific paper that you haven't seen yet. It will relate to some of the things that we've talked about, and you will have to consider what they did in the paper. There'll be some specific questions about, okay, so go to this figure, look and see what they did, and then determine what they found based on that. And so that'll be the sort of assignment for the take-home part. And you'll have 2 hours to do that part. We're going to today mostly be doing like sort of traditional lecture-ish sort of material today and Monday. But then on Wednesday and Thursday, we're going to be talking about some scientific research that relates to the stuff we're talking about for today and Monday. And then on, I think, Friday, we're moving back into like more lecture sort of material. Then the following Monday and the rest of the week is going to be kind of a mix of scientific research and lecture stuff, so that you will have opportunities in there to look at and glance through and discuss scientific papers in class, and that will hopefully help prepare you for the exam as well as help prepare you to write the report, which also the report hopefully will help you for the take-home part of the exam. And one other note about the reports, so in addition to working on your outlines, please send me like drafts or questions. Don't get stuck on them. The papers are not written for you. A textbook is written for you as an audience. The papers are not written for you as an audience. They're written for people with PhDs as an audience, which means that there's going to be stuff in those papers that you don't understand, and I don't really expect you to understand all of it. The goal is for you to be able to get the main ideas out of the paper and see some of the experiments that are done and think about how some of those experiments relate to the goal, the question, the hypothesis that the researchers are working on. You will probably get stuck at a few places. Please email me as soon as you get stuck trying to understand things. You also probably will not understand all of the methods, and you can either email me with questions about that or just kind of skip it. And focus in on the abstract and the results and the introduction. And those are going to be the places where you're going to see the main ideas, the main experiments that they did, and the relationship between those things. The discussion will also help some too. But for this, you don't need to go into the methods section and go into extensive detail about the methodology that they do. In this paper is actually a bad example. But let's go back and look at the one that we had last time. So this paper, for example, if I were reading this, I would read the abstract and the introduction first. And that gives you a sense of the overall paper, including the abstract has a little bit of background, a little bit of methods. So for example, we equipped the owls with prismatic spectacles that optically displaced the field by 23 degrees, and we restored normal vision. So that's kind of like that's almost all you need for the methods. And then in terms of the results, the auditory space map was restricted to an early sensitive period, Then, unlike previous experiments, we have the capacity to restore normal sound after normal vision was restored. And so right there, that's most of what you need. We've got experiment one, it's young owls adapt, old owls don't. Experiment two, if you make an owl reorganize as a young owl, then take it off as an adult, it can restore the normal map. You'll have to look into the results to get a little bit more detail for your report, but that's giving you the main idea right there. And then they go in and describe some of what they think is going on and why that's important. And so the abstract already gives you a lot of what you need. The introduction is written in to be more approachable and designed to give you some background about what they're doing. And in addition to that, usually the last paragraph of the introduction, or sometimes the last couple paragraphs, they give another sort of brief summary of their results. Materials and methods, unless there's something that's totally unclear, you mostly just skip that, and generally just entirely skip that. Actually, a lot of papers now don't even put methods in the publication. They just throw them up online, because unless you're trying to replicate the experiment, which you're not, then going into the methods isn't very, very informative. And so instead, you see in the results here, they will restate for each experiment what they did in concise terms that are more approachable. So to assess the developmental map, we had 39 owls. We put prismatic spectacles on them in ages ranging from 13 days old to over 2 years. For example, here, this owl PR18 raised normally until 18 days of age, equipped with 23 degree spectacles. Like, that's what you need for the methods. They put in the results enough that you can understand the basics of what they're doing. So after this owl was equipped with these spectacles, then we measured the interaural timing difference response curve, and we see that in figure 1A. And so then we go over to figure 1A and we say, okay, before prisms, it's centered right at zero, meaning he looks up when sounds are played in the 2 years at the same time, he looks straight ahead. And then afterwards, he looks straight ahead when sounds are played and the left ear slightly before the right. And that is like the core of what you need. And then for this other adult owl, that adult owl will be described in the results in words, and you can also look at the figure. And so that's sort of how you, and then there you go, that's experiment one. And then you just need to explain the core of the methods and the results and link it back to this idea of maybe there's this sensitive period in development. And so the difference between these two owls is the age at which they got the prisms on, and one adapted, one didn't. And so that sort of, and then sort of explicitly link it back to this, to the main questions of the paper. And so that's mostly what there is to do. What questions do people have about like how to approach these papers? Yeah, sure. Right. Yeah, that's the hardest part of this assignment is looking for a flaw in the paper. So, let's rather than answer that, actually, I think it'll probably be useful. Let's take a little break for about 5 minutes and get together with groups and kind of recall these papers. Unfortunately, I don't have the printouts anymore, but think back about what they did. And in particular, just kind of like the two major experiments that we've got are our owl, we've got young versus old owl here, and then the old owl can readapt back here. And so anything that you could maybe change about the experiment to make it a little bit better, or something that might be going on in the owl's brain that they might not be considering. Or also like other experiments that you could do in addition to this. And that's a hard question, but we'll just kind of try and brainstorm for about 5 minutes, and then we'll come back and try and discuss together as a group. And since this is such a hard question, Megan and I will be walking around too while you're working on it, so that you don't get totally lost. But let's actually spend a couple of minutes trying to brainstorm, because I think that'll be useful as you're approaching. Okay, it's been about 5 minutes, and I imagine people are still. I know this is hard, so I don't want people to struggle too long on their own. So. What thoughts do people have about what might be a shortcoming? Sure, yeah.
What is it? I said this to Angela. With my limited knowledge of lab reports, it is my understanding that you can find discussion about error and mistakes in the results of the conclusion section.
Yeah.
Or discussion section. So if you go there and you read it thoroughly, you can probably find some place where they say, this other study proved this, and this is against that. So
yeah.
I'll just follow up on that.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, actually, I should have suggested this before, but in part since we didn't have the papers in front of us, maybe wasn't going to work. So right here in the discussion section, so their conclusion, the main conclusion was that the owl has the adult owl has two maps. When you remap it as a juvenile, it still retains the young map. But they say that maybe, the wording's a little bit funky, but they say the asymmetry may be because of the quality of visual experience may be different with and without prisms. Essentially, the prisms are not perfect. And so in addition to shifting the world, because you're viewing it through prisms, the prisms might be a little bit wonky and distorted. And so it might be hard, when you put a prism on an adult, you're not only asking it to remap, you're also asking it to see through this sort of like distorted image. And that may be too hard an adjustment to make. Whereas when you take the prism off, the animal's like, oh, thank goodness, now everything's clear again. And now, because everything's clear, that's why it can adjust back. And so it's sort of a methodological limitation, potentially. They make some arguments, which you can read, as to why that's not likely. But as they state, they can't rule it out. And so that's one thing, just like heading to the discussion. And in addition to that, there are other things that you can pull out of the discussion that may be helpful as well. So they say there may be an innate bias toward quote-unquote normal connections, and that may be why they're able to adjust back but not adjust forward. So it's not that they have two maps; it's just that the brain is sort of has some genetic program that says what the normal map should be, and so it's easier to move toward that bias than away from that bias. And then you can start to even use that. So you want to be. It would be okay to say like quality of visual experience, like the prisms are distorted as a shortcoming, and then this is pretty unrelated. The idea of innate bias toward other connections is a different idea, and that could even be your follow-up experiment. You could say, we can say, okay, let's actually, after we're done with the owls, look in their brains and try and follow the paths and see, are there two different in this owl that we've adjusted its brain, are there two different axonal paths that are there? One that represents the normal map, but has probably got silent synapses, and maybe you can even look to put on an antibody that stains for AMPA receptors, or just say we'll look and see if there are AMPA receptors at one set and not the other set. And so by doing that, that will give you also a follow-up experiment. And so for both the shortcoming and the follow-up, the discussion is very helpful because often they hint at possible other mechanisms that could be provide a basis for a shortcoming or a follow-up experiment or both. I heard you all had a couple ideas too. Yeah.
Potential follow-up more than a.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great idea, and that you could spin that either as a shortcoming or as a follow-up. Either way is fine, but you could say the problem with the adults is that they're not being motivated enough. We know that motivation is important, especially for adults. Along those same lines, you could also say, well, maybe the juveniles have more dopamine in their brains than the adults. We should measure dopamine concentration. That could be a shortcoming. Or we just need to, you could call it a shortcoming that the adults might not have been motivated sufficiently, or you could call it a follow-up. You couldn't do both. You have to find independent things for the shortcoming and follow-up as part of the assignment. But you could spin that either way. Yeah. What else? What other? Yeah. Yeah.
So for this part of the assignment, do you want us to look through the discussion and see they say that we can follow up with this and this and this and then come up with something else or take an idea from that?
You can totally take an idea from the discussion. Yes. Yeah. That is going to be by far the easier thing to do, and it is completely fine, and it's a great way to go. In fact, I would say that I recommend that you go to the discussion to find the follow-up ideas. Yeah. Sometimes if you think of something on your own, you could check. You can always check in with me and be like, I saw this in the discussion. I think this is how I would spin it into a follow-up, or how I would spin it into a shortcoming. That's great. Or you can say, I thought of this, and it wasn't in the discussion, but I think it could be a shortcoming. And please, please check in with me if you have any questions about it. The whole point of the outline is so that it forces you to check in with me a week before with your whole plan. And if you're struggling, then it gets that. But even before the outline's due, over the weekend, whatever, just let me know what you're thinking about this. Yeah. What else did you all have any thoughts? What did you discuss in your group? Yeah, they did do left and right, and I think they lumped them together, but that could be a follow-up experiment to say, is left easier than right? Is right easier than left? That would be a follow-up. Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Yeah, sure.
We had also talked about the same thing. You guys said kind of look in the brain once they're done.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We could also try kind of follow-up in a different mammal, maybe?
Mm-hmm, yeah. Yeah, I think those are both great ideas. And you could spin you could sort of say the looking in the brain could either be a shortcoming like, hey, they should have looked in the brain and they didn't, or it could just be like, okay, well, yeah, they got this and now the next step is to look and see what's going on in the brain. It's harder to say that it's sort of necessary to do multiple animals in a single study and make that a shortcoming, but that's an outstanding follow-up. And you could do that, you could say, okay, we should try this in monkeys. You can say we should even try this in humans, put prism goggles on humans and see how they adapt, see if it's easier or harder for adults. That's something you can totally do in a person. And that would be a great follow-up to this, yeah. And that's also like another kind of way to take a follow-up is to just say, okay, well, how generalizable is this? So they've got some conclusion, but it's restricted to whatever experimental setup they've got. Can we probe that same conclusion in a different experimental setting, often meaning a different experimental animal, or maybe if So you can go either way with that. You could have a human study and say, okay, well, we've got this phenomenon in humans. I want to understand what's going on with it. Let's see if we can get a mouse or a monkey or whatever to do something like what those people did, and then see if we can now record neural activity more directly in that animal in an invasive way that we can't with the human. That's a great follow-up. Or you can say, we've got something where we've got a strong, they've already probed neural activity in an experimental animal, and now I want to see if the same sort of phenomenon occurs in people with this coarser sort of recording methods that we have for humans. So either way, like that, sort of moving along to either move up toward humans and say how generalizable is this, or move down toward like smaller experimental animals and say what are the neural mechanisms. Those are both great ways to approach a follow-up. Other questions about this, the kind of report stuff? We're not going to spend a whole lot of time on this because after looking through everybody's discussion, everybody's group notes from yesterday, it seems like everybody really had a pretty solid understanding of this. So for this paper, as before, in adult owl, give them a single large step prism, can't adjust. Take a different adult owl, give them a 6-degree prism and they adjust to that, an 11-degree prism and they do pretty well adjusting to that, and then a 17-degree prism. They don't get all the way, so the height of this is where they should get to. So they fully adjust to the 6-degree, don't get about halfway to the 11, and get about a third of the way to the 17. But nonetheless, this animal has made some pretty significant adjustments, much better if you compare this animal here to this one here that was a single 17-degree prism. This one's doing a heck of a lot better. And you take the prisms off, the animal goes right back to behaving, to having the old map, just like we saw before with the animals that were trained as juveniles and had the prisms removed as an adult. And then you put the prism back on, they switch right back, on, off, they just sort of switch, just fine. This owl did even better than his friend over here. This owl basically completely adapted to the 6 and 11 degree prisms, got even closer to the 17, and then they put a really powerful 23 degree prism on the owl. And again, the animal gets almost the full way there to adapting appropriately to this. And then take the prism off, they switch back, put it back on, they switch back again, on, off, the animal's got the two maps stored. I think of this as informative and relating to the fixing my gaze story in a lot of ways, because in that case she had to train herself in small steps. She couldn't just like, okay, go see 3 dimensions, go do it. That wasn't working. She had to go through sort of small incremental training. The small incremental training probably also helps with motivation. You put a 6-degree prism on the owl, and it's not bumping into things all the time. It's almost there, and it just needs to make a little adjustment. And so it's easier to sort of be motivated to like make that small shift than it is when it's just like the whole world has gone crazy on you, and you have no idea what the heck to even do. And so the small incremental steps probably help with motivation. You could hypothesize about neuromodulators being involved, dopamine being released as the animal makes tiny strides toward a small adjustment. It's going to do better than if it makes a tiny stride toward a really large adjustment. It's probably just going to get frustrated. That's putting a lot of thoughts into an owl's head, but you can imagine how incremental training allows you to have incremental rewards, which is much more satisfying than failing at a giant step all at once. But everyone seemed to pretty well capture the core points of this paper. Any questions about that? Yeah, sure. Yeah. Certainly like checking in about how they make their measurements, it can definitely be the foundation of a shortcoming. I'm not sure, it's not immediately obvious to me what other measurement they would make. But yeah, it's that's a great starting place to think about what might be a shortcoming, and then and even if you just have that, like I can't think of anything right this minute, but maybe if you know you email me with a question like that about okay, this I don't think this measurement's quite right. Maybe here's why I'm not sure it's quite right, but I don't know what else I could have done. Like then we could kind of have an exchange about whether that's going to work. So yeah, and that is definitely a great way to approach this idea of finding a shortcoming or a follow-up. Yeah. Yeah. Other questions about either this paper or about the report that's coming up, where your outline's due later next week. Okay. All right. So. Today, so that's it for stuff that's going to be on the exam on Tuesday. Now we're going to switch over to new material relevant for the homework that's due on Monday, but not going to be on the exam. And this is the goal really for the next 2 weeks is to think about is to come up with some mathematical ways that we can think about how brains process information and use that as a way to understand how we can provide a sort of clear quantitative description of sensation and perception in a sort of general sense that applies across multiple sensory systems, and also how we can understand the connection between action potentials in motor areas in the brain and the motor commands that they set off. And so we're going to be first sort of talking in general terms about information, and then moving on to more specific terms about encoding of information, which is the process of taking things out in the world and converting it into action potentials in my brain. And then decoding of information, which is either the process of those action potentials being read out by the rest of my brain into a perception, or those action potentials being read by a computer that might be hooked up to something recording from my brain, and the computer making a guess about what I'm perceiving or what I'm seeing. And then after we do that, that's sort of this week. Then next week we're going to be extending that to think about motor systems and how we can use neural activity to make a guess about what an animal or a person intends to do in terms of a motor movement, and how we can explore the sort of space of motor movements that are out there. And so the quote that I have up there is from a professor who used to be here at CMU. He's moved to the University of Pittsburgh, Nathan Urban. He's a neurobiologist, and he studies sensory systems and has a very quantitative approach to how he studies sensory systems. And he said, and I think it really accurately captures a lot of what we're going to be talking about, that the goal of a sensory system is to represent, transmit, and extract information about the world. And so those ideas are all three ideas, especially representation and extraction of information, are all ideas that we're going to be talking a lot about. But to represent something for us means that there's some way in which pattern of action potentials going on in my brain has some correlation or relationship with what's out there in the world. So when my eyes are closed and I'm seeing nothing, then there's some pattern of action potentials in my brain that transmits that there's nothing being seen. And when I open my eyes and I look around, as I look at different people's faces, different patterns of action potentials start happening in my brain. And those different patterns of action potentials have some relationship with which face I'm looking at. And that relationship is a representation. That's what we mean by representation, is that there's a relationship between one pattern of things, action potentials in my brain, and another pattern of things, the photons out there or the face out there or whatever. And so in terms of transmission, all that comes into my eye, and then it needs to get from my eye to the back of my brain and then further process throughout. And so that transmission is sort of getting the stuff that went into my eye into my brain, and action potentials accomplish that by traveling along an axon. And then once we've created some representation in my visual cortex, some pattern of action potentials that corresponds to the face I'm looking at, and it's made it to my visual cortex, the next step is to decode it and to extract that information and get that information out so that I know not just the shape and size of noses and eyes, but I get a representation and a full, I sort of pull out from the shape of the eyes and the shape of the nose and the shape of the mouth and whatever, I pull out from all of that who it is that I'm looking at, what face I'm looking at. And so that is what we're going to be doing and talking about. But this is the plan really for most of the next week. Today we're probably going to almost exclusively just talk about point number one. But to plan ahead for the next week, we're going to be first talking about what is information, what makes something informative, how can we quantify information. And then the next thing that we're going to talk about is returning to this idea of labeled lines and encoding. I should have taken firing rate, should have been moved down there. Anyway, and then talk about encoding and decoding. And then we're going to talk about some more advanced math involving what's called Bayesian probability. It's not too onerous, but there is a little bit of calculation that we're going to be doing, both in terms of quantifying information and then a little bit more, slightly more complicated, but still manageable calculations in terms of probability. And we'll get to that probably Wednesday, maybe Monday. And then we'll start talking about how we can take all of this and go from action potentials to a perception, if it's a brain doing the decoding, or if it's a computer doing a decoding, go from action potentials that we've recorded in some animal's brain and make a guess about what the animal is looking at. And then the last thing, which is going to actually turn into most of Wednesday and Thursday and probably even into Friday, is thinking about the precise timing of action potentials. In other words, does it matter how many action potentials a neuron fires, or does it matter not only how many, but whether it's sort of versus same five action potentials but in a different pattern? Does that mean something? And so that's the question. Do those represent different things? And so that's going to be the question that we'll talk about in the sort of later parts of next week. But for today, first of all, we're going to, most of this is actually going to be just on the board, so I'm going to clear this guy out of here. Okay, so I'm going to play a couple different games. The first game, We're going to sort of switch a little bit between them. So there's three. Do you remember? Those were the three animal names that EP had in that video we watched a few weeks ago: dog, raccoon, lion, and a parrot. And so I am going to randomly pick one of those names, and your job is to guess that name. And before you make a final guess, you need to be right on your guess. You have to be absolutely certain when you make your guess. But before you make the guess, you can ask me as many yes or no questions as you want, in order to get before you can say, okay, I'm certain. Now I'm ready to make my guess. And so the question that I'm asking you now is, how many questions do you need? It's sort of, did anyone ever watch Name That Tune, or am I just like way too old? It's like this, yeah, can I guess that? I can guess that song in three notes. I can name the song. So how many yes or no questions do you need to ask me before you can be certain about which of those I've picked at random? And let's actually just take like a minute and a half and try and come up in a group with a number of how many questions you think, and see if you can agree with whoever your partners or groups are about how many questions it's going to take to answer that. So you can join over with them. Yeah, we want to get to the point that you're sure. Yeah.
Yeah, you won't look at the connection between you only look at the connection between two things. So a dog and a pet, or they can be raccoon and lion cannot be. So you can say, can it be a common pet?
Yeah,
if it's yes, that means it's a dog and a parrot, that means that you can ask, is it a dog? If it's not, it's a parrot. And then if it's not, then you can say, is it a raccoon? If it's not, it's a lion.
All right, so let's come back and I guess so how many questions do you, sure, yeah, you can do it in two. Okay, yeah, so what about this group? I heard this group, what they came up with, two. Okay, yeah, and what two would you use?
If it's a pet,
yeah, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Or you know, or even just is, you know. So if I say is it a pet, and I say no, then you're left with raccoon and lion, and then you can say you can just say is it a lion, and if I say yes, then you're sure it's a lion. If I say no, then you're sure it's a. So I think a lot of people's first guess was three, maybe even four. That's often sort of the first approach. Like, okay, is it a dog? No. Is it a raccoon? No. Is it a lion? No. Okay, it's a parrot. And that's an okay way to do it, but it's not. But it's not optimal. The optimal way is to sort of divide things in half. And so the variant on this game, or the more complicated version of this game, is a game called 20 Questions, where again you get 20 yes/no questions. And now I'm thinking not of one of these four things, because you can do that in two questions, but I'm thinking of something. I'm thinking of a word. So we'll sort of put this game aside for a minute. We'll come back to it in a bit. But so I'm thinking of something. How would you start a game of 20 questions? What might be a good question to ask to start? Sure. Yeah. Really.
Is it alive?
Is it alive? Sure. Is it alive? I'll say no to that. I should think of my thing before I go further. So is alive? No. That is a great question to ask. There are like good questions and bad questions to ask in 20 questions. I tried to play 20 questions with my 5-year-old a little while ago, and I said, so I'm thinking of something. He said, so is it that chair? No. 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 Is it the table? No. Could be a great strategy, right? Maybe it was the chair. Maybe it's the first question. He's got it. Like, could be great. But it's unlikely to get you pretty far pretty fast. And you're going to use up 20 questions way before. And so instead of doing that, you want to sort of clump things together into categories that allow you to divide the world up. And most optimally, you actually want to divide the world up such that 50% of the probabilities go on one side and 50% of the other probabilities go on the other side. So in a certain sense, is it alive is actually kind of a mediocrely bad question, because if I'm picking anything in the universe, most things in the universe are not alive. Even anything on the planet, most things on the planet are not alive. There are grains of sand galore all over the planet, and I could be thinking of any one of those grains of sand. And so that makes it kind of a poor choice in a sense. But it's actually not so terrible, because I'm biased toward living things, being one myself. And so based on that bias, you can sort of say, there's probably about a 50% chance that he's got something alive and a 50% chance that he's got something that's not. And so that makes it actually a pretty good question to do. Let's say another question. What else might you ask? So it's not alive. Is it a concept? Interesting. Yeah. That's a great question. It's not a concept. It's actually something concrete. But that's again, like, I'm alive. I'm mostly a brain. At least the parts of me that are playing this game are mostly a brain. I'm again biased toward concepts. Most things aren't concepts. There are a heck of a lot more hydrogen atoms out there than concepts. That's still a pretty good approach to take. Okay, and so And so when you're thinking about information quantification, we're sort of thinking about playing games of 20 questions. And so here, we have four possibilities equals two questions that are needed. If we start to play a different game, this game now, I've got16 boxes, and hidden inside one of those 16 boxes is a dollar bill. And you get to open one box, and you want to be certain about where that dollar bill is before you open it. So we've got four times as many possibilities as before. How many questions are we going to need for that? Are we going to need eight questions because it's four times as many possibilities? So how would you do this with four questions?
Is it on this half?
Yeah, so you'd say, okay, is it on the right half or the left half? And I say, no, not on the right half, or not on the left half. Okay.
And then top half or bottom half.
Yeah, and then top half or bottom half. So you say, they'll say, yes, it's on the top half. And then
left half.
Maybe left or right. So then so I'll say, no, it's not left. And then you would ask, okay, is it here? And I say, yes. And so then you cross this off, and then you open that drawer and you get your dollar. So when we have 16 possibilities, then that's four questions. And so in general, if all, there's sort of a caveat here, and we'll discuss how you get around it too, but if all the possibilities are equally likely, then the uncertainty, which actually we're going to, which is the same thing as entropy. And last semester, Megan had to watch a whole series of videos that I put together about how uncertainty and entropy relate. I'm not going to force you to do that, but you're welcome to do that. And I'll send out the link about that. So the uncertainty, which we're going to call entropy, and in thermodynamics, entropy is S. We talked about that way back at the very beginning. For this, in this special condition where all the possibilities are equally likely, then S is just equal to the log base 2 of the number of possibilities. And then that is S given in units of bits. So bits is an artificial creation that we use because it allows us to describe how we're storing information and also describe how we're narrowing down the process as sort of this binary search of put half the things in one side, half the things in the other, and then you get your answer about that, then narrow it down and cut that subgroup in half and cut that subgroup in half. And so S in bits is log base 2 of the number of possibilities. Okay, any questions about that? Yeah.
So on the computer science, we have binary, and then the one.
Yeah. And this is exactly, hard drives, everything all works on bits, and that's what, a fully compressed file, and actually the video series kind of goes into this a little bit, which I'll send out. But a fully compressed data file that has maximum information in it is a string of ones and zeros, where every digit, every bit, narrows down the possibilities about what that file might be by 50%. English is pretty redundant, right? So if I have something like this. This is stolen from XKCD because I read that all the time. But like you can figure out what's missing in that blank, right? It's probably not the volcano's probably not erasing. The volcano's probably erupting. So you can figure that out from this. And so English is pretty redundant, but a compressed data file, if you lose some of the bits, you can't get them back. That's kind of the definition of a fully compressed data file with maximum information in it. Okay, and then we can also talk about, back over here. So we've got one situation where all the possibilities are equally likely. If the possibilities have unequal probability, then we need to do a more complicated thing, which is that S equals the negative sum from the first item up to the last item of the probability of each item times the log base 2 of the probability of each item. And we can see that that's equivalent to the first one if we say, okay, so 16 possibilities that are equally likely. So log base 2 of 16, and by the way, you get calculators on the exam, so you can figure that out. But you should get a calculator that you can do log base 2 on. Or if you can't do log base 2, you should look up how to convert between log 10 and log 2 if that's all your calculator does. But anyway, log base 2 of 16 equals 4. So that's our 4 bits. And then if we do the more complicated way, then we are going to have, I shouldn't have done 16. We'll do 8. Makes life a little easier. 8, 3. Okay, so if we do the more complicated way, then we're going to add up the probability of the first of it being in the first spot is 1/8 times log base 2 of 1/8 plus 1/8 times log base 2 of 1/8. On and on and on and on, so until we've done that 8 times, and then we put all of that in a negative sign, and so the log base 2 of 1/8 is -3. We have an 1/8 of -3 added to itself 8 times, and so that ends up being -3, or 3 bits. And the homework assignment has you work through several of these calculations, so you get a lot of practice. That's the homework assignment for this weekend, and so you'll get an opportunity to explore a little bit with that. Okay, so that's really kind of one of the core. This is the core concept for most of the next 2 weeks is understanding this idea of information and bits and uncertainty and narrowing things down. So what questions do people have about that? Okay, well, we're going to do a group activity in just a second, and hopefully it'll give you a chance. If I see a couple faces that look confused, and it looks like maybe people don't even know how to ask a question that they have yet. So in this activity, hopefully you'll have an opportunity to explore a little bit and think about what's unclear. But before we do that, I want to, for the basis of this activity, we're going to come back to our dog, raccoon, lion, and parrot here. And so instead of answering yes/no questions about this animal, you know that I've got one of these. That's what I'm thinking of. And then you hear me saying the is a filthy animal. And you didn't make out this word, in there, but you know it was one of those four. And so the question is, did that give you information? And if it did, how can you figure out, give a numerical answer, how much? So, and so what we had before was we had how much uncertainty before, our S prior, before you heard me say that, the prior to hearing me say that, your uncertainty was 2 bits. So that's how much uncertainty you had before. And the question is, if you, and you can make some numerical assumptions if you want to here, but the question is, how much information did this give you, and how can we figure that out? And this is, again, a very hard question. Please write your names on the papers, and we'll turn them in. But I'm definitely going to be, Megan and I are definitely going to be around with. All right, awesome. OK, cool, great. So it looks like everybody's all done. And I think just looking at this, you've all intuitively come up with something that I didn't explicitly tell you, which is cool. So over here, we're going to first, before we talk about the what you just did, I want to go back to sort of a simpler case. So we've got, here are 16 boxes, coins hidden in one of those. And so you ask your first question, and your first question is on the right, and I say yes, those are gone. Then you say, is it in the top half? And I say no, so those are gone. And so now, so our S prior is 4 bits. And then our S, we can call it S residual, is what I usually use. And our S residual is now down to 2 bits. And so then we say the information, officially information gained is better, but we'll be a little bit sloppy. The video series that I'll email out, which by the way, again, is optional, explains that sort of technically speaking, uncertainty is the wrong word, and we should really be calling entropy and information equivalent, but that gets a little bit confusing. And so we're just going to say S is uncertainty, and then our information is what we've gained. So it's our 2 bits, because that is equal to 4. So our it's our S prior minus S residual. That's how we calculate the information gained. And so if you got to a final answer, then your residual uncertainty is 0, and so your gained information is 4 bits. And so you can calculate how much information you've gained by just subtracting how uncertain you were before versus how uncertain you were after. And the point of this exercise here, and I think all of the groups came to this conclusion, is that we don't, is that in this arrangement where I said this, I could, you know, raccoon's probably the most likely. A lot of people do think dogs are filthy, so maybe that's in there too. Lions, sometimes male lions eat babies when they come into a new pride and take over from a previous dominant. So I could be thinking about that. But and parrots, you know, they poop everywhere, so maybe I think that they're the filthy animal. But you know, it's more likely raccoon, maybe dog, and lion and parrot seem pretty unlikely. But you can't rule them out. You know, it's a perfectly legitimate sentence to say that the lion is a filthy animal. It's you can't completely rule it out, but you can judge it to be pretty improbable. And so in these simple cases, we gain information by eliminating possibilities. And it's sort of straightforward to see how that's a gain of information. But in these more complex cases, we can actually gain information without eliminating any possibilities and just by changing the probability distribution. So maybe we can get this. So, and different groups came up with different things. Depending on the probabilities you put in there, you can, so this group gave very low probabilities to 2 and a pretty high probability to the parrot, I think, 75% to the parrot, and then everything else was pretty low probability. And so this is a pretty unequal distribution here in this group because it's almost all of our probabilities is over in raccoon, and so we gain almost a full bit of information, which means that's almost as good as a yes-no question, as one yes-no question. Not quite as good as a yes-no question, but almost as good as a yes-no question. This other group here looks like they distributed the probabilities a little bit more equally. Thought that maybe lion is sort of less likely, but the probabilities are a little bit less unevenly distributed, and so they have a residual uncertainty of nearly 2 bits, almost as much as we started with, and only gained a tiny bit of information. And that's totally fine. I mean, you were supposed to be sort of making assumptions on this. And then this group, I think, fell a little bit in between, where it's not quite as skewed, quite as uneven a distribution as the first group, but it's a little bit more uneven than the second group. And so they get an intermediate amount of information between those. And so this kind of leads into 2 points that I wanted to make about information. The first is that you can gain information without eliminating a possibility. And the way you gain information without eliminating a possibility is by having a good guess afterwards. So after I said that, you can't be certain that it's a raccoon the way you could if you'd asked me 2 yes-no questions, assuming I'm not lying to you. But a raccoon's a pretty good guess off of that. And so having a good guess means that you have kind of a better chance of getting it right earlier. And so when the probabilities become uneven, that does give you some likely options and some unlikely options. And that means you've got more information to go on than if you just have, I don't know, no guess, equally likely for all of those. That's sort of like, I have no clue. It could be any of those 4. Whereas, okay, now I have a clue. It doesn't completely rule anything out, but there's a clue there. And so that clue is information. We can actually quantify how much information comes from that clue. And then the second point that's related to that is that, so this was sort of a checkerboard example, kind of like the 16 squares, except it was with 25. But if you have, if all of if the probability that the coin is hidden in any of these 25 spots is equally likely, then that is going to be the maximum uncertainty. Is when you have no prior guess. And as the distribution gets more and more narrow and some spots become more likely than others, then that changes the amount of uncertainty that you have. You get less and less uncertainty as it gets more and more uneven. Even if there's still like a 0.001% chance that it's on any of these other squares. Even if these ones don't go to 0 entirely and we don't completely eliminate the possibilities, as we just skew the distribution so that there are good guesses and bad guesses, or there are likely things and unlikely things, that will gain us some information. Often not as much as a yes-no question, but we can get pretty close, especially like with the set of assumptions that this one group made here. Where they had a really uneven distribution, if we can see it, a really uneven distribution, which was totally a legitimate guess to make. And if we made it even more uneven so that the raccoon was like 95% or 96% and everything else was 0.1, 0.1, 0.1, or maybe the dog is 0.2 and then everything else is 0.1, then that would actually, if you calculate that out, that's going to be worth more than 1 bit of information because we've got a really, really good guess that it's the raccoon. And so even without eliminating any possibilities, you could get to a situation where you have more information than even a single yes-no question can give you. Okay, so what questions do people have about any of this? Here, let me expose the board again so we can see everything we've been talking about. So about how to calculate information, the special case which you can forget if you want to, but if everything's equal, you can use the shortcut of just saying the log of the number of possibilities, but the general case of adding up all of the different probability times the log of the probability for each individual case. Or about calculating information, or about unequal versus equal distributions, or anything else. What questions do people have about any of that? Really? Okay, so the homework's going to be helpful for that, but a couple more things I want to talk about in the last 5 minutes before everyone packs up, because we still have five more minutes here. And so the way this relates to brains and to the nervous system is that, so I am, the sort of aware parts of me are this brain buried deep inside a skull. And that brain doesn't have access to the outside world. I don't, you know, sense things by pulling my brain out of my skull and rubbing it all over something and then plopping it back in. There's no direct contact between the brain in here and the outside world. It all comes in through some action potentials and goes out through action potentials that the brain collects and then transmits around. And that's how I interact with the world. And our sensors that we have, the sensors out on our body, are pretty good and pretty reliable, all things considered. So when I touch this desk, some action potentials come in through the axons, and that gives me information that, okay, I have action potentials coming in on axons from here and here, so those two fingers touch the desk, and not on this one here, because that one didn't touch that time. And so that gives me a sense, you know, of where the desk is, the shape, and so on and so forth. I can kind of explore. Same thing with my visual system or my auditory system. I hear different frequencies of sound. That gives me these different perceptions. But the sensors are not perfect. Sometimes the sensors make mistakes and fire action potentials when they are not getting the stimulus that's supposed to make them fire an action potential. And sometimes I can make contact with something and a sensor doesn't fire an action potential. And so it's kind of like playing 20 questions with the world, but every once in a while the world lies to you. And it either says yes and fires an action potential when there's nothing there, or it says no and doesn't fire an action potential when there is something there that it should be responding to. And so when we get action potentials coming in, that doesn't guarantee that something is out there, but it makes it more likely that something is out there when those action potentials come in. And when we're not getting action potentials coming in, then it makes it less likely. It doesn't guarantee there's nothing out there. Maybe our sensors just forgot to fire that time. They're noisy. They make mistakes. And so, and this is the basis of a lot of different types of sensory illusions and so on. But as you are experiencing the world as this brain stuck inside a skull, you're getting mostly useful information, but every once in a while you're getting some inputs that are erroneous and also missing some things that should be coming in. And so our brains don't function by eliminating possibilities or guaranteeing possibilities. Our brains function by making their best guesses about what's out there, given the sort of noisy information that we've got. And since our sensors are somewhat faulty, good enough that they get us by, but they make mistakes, we're sort of more over in this situation here than we are over in this situation here. We can't be guaranteed that we're seeing what we perceive, but when we have those action potentials coming in, it makes it likely that it was a raccoon and not a parrot or whatever. And so that's kind of how this all relates. And so over the next couple of classes, we're going to be talking about how those action potentials are encoded and decoded by our nervous system, and then also how we can even make an even better guess about what's out there, not just taking into account those action potentials, but also taking into account our what knowledge we already have about the world. And that sort of relates to the fact that you understand what I'm saying in part because the sounds that are coming out of my mouth are interacting with your auditory system in the right way, in part because you're looking at me and you see my gestures and my facial expression, and in part because you already can assume that the words coming out of my mouth are going to be in English, and all of these sort of prior pieces of knowledge that help you to build this coherent picture. And so that's the sort of the goal that we're going to be going toward over the next couple of classes.